Okay. testing, 1, 2, 3.
A good thing you're good at planning ahead.
All right, let's see. I got to mute YouTube. There we go. All right, so let me double check everything. I can see the YouTube chat. I can hear and see you guys. I can drop the microphone. Well, I've been running, running around the last 20 minutes. Sorry. All right. Good to see you guys. Sorry I didn't dress up all fancy today. I'm in sweatshirt. Look at me. I'm a disaster. But you guys are beautiful. All right. Luckily, I got 3 screens on my laptop. That works out fantastic. All right. Happy Sunday. Welcome to Off the Charts with Wayne McDonald, everyone. I am sorry for my tardiness. I was literally in a meeting and all of a sudden, 3:31. Oh, I gotta go. So good to see you. All right, so, you guys okay with the cigar? Anyone going to go with the cigar today?
Smells good.
I'm good. I got a fan on.
who's got a... I got my newspaper. I got a lighter that might work. I got a cigar that needs a lighter, but I need a cutter. I have a wine cutter from last week. Is that cool? Where did my cutter go? All right. So anyways, how did last week go? Did you guys enjoy the election and all the craziness? What did you guys learn? I heard someone in the pre-meeting say, I really learned something on Tuesday. So who was it and what did you learn?
Learn not to trade elections.
Oh, what happened there? Were you pushing or did you have profit and give it back or?
Oh yeah, I was up like 250 points in the morning, gave it all back to break even. Later in the evening, I was up a couple hundred, went that back to break even. And then it went downhill from there.
So what happens, I guess what it shows you is there's kind of 2 things going on. There's the pre-game bet that market participants make. They're like, I bet you this is going up. Yeah. And it's a good thing to do. I mean, I threw down the same thing, but that's one trade in of itself, right? So I think when we started the live webinar on Tuesday night, I think it was up like 800 pips. So that's the pre-game pip. Pre-game bet, if you want. Now, the next one is sort of the real, truly fundamental trade. It's not the volatility. It's when the market has decided it knows enough information about who is going to win and the risks and rewards associated with that win. And like I said, there isn't good or bad. It's more like what uncertainties come with the new president or whatever, right? And we didn't actually figure that out to the next day. So what happened is the pregame bet had everything up, and then it all came back down once we realized that bet may be an unclear bet. And then really nothing else happened on Tuesday. And the interesting thing is it went up to key pivots and then down to key pivots, and then it ended, you know, like the next morning was almost like right where we had started. So, so the second one is the trade that's based on the uncertainty going away, not the volatility, not really a bet. And that happened really for me, I think, Wednesday afternoon, not Tuesday evening, right? So it was another 24 hours once we realized what was likely to happen. And that's when I threw a bunch of trades down again. But you have to think about it as pieces, right? Because there's different people trading for different kinds of reasons. And I think that's the best thing to grasp. It wasn't disappointing. It was that there was 2 or 3 different things going on. Yeah. And of course, this time, I think the big learning experience was also how much we rely on the mail-in ballots now. Because, man, you must feel for Trump where he's like, I got all of this. One, I'm up 5 points, right? Like Biden is 600,000 votes away from me. Like, I got this wrapped up. And then the next day he's like, what? Oh, he must have been counting those victories for sure. So that's maybe different from years past, or at least I remember it differently this year. So, yeah. So the interesting thing with the politics now isn't the election, it's what's going to go on in the Senate, because we figured that was all wrapped up. But Georgia might go Democrat in the Senate. And that changes everything. So luckily, I moved to Georgia because I knew this was going to happen 20 years ago, right? So here's the thing. There's a normal election going on for the Senate seat here in Georgia. And so there's one Republican and one Democrat fighting over it. And that's pretty close, but the Republican's probably going to win, I would guess. But we don't know, right? But in Georgia, not only do you have to have the most votes, but you have to win at least by 50%, right? You have to have at least 50%. And neither of them have it. So they're going to have to do a runoff. So there's going to be another election. I think it's a giant waste of money, but they can do whatever they want. It's their country. So there's that. But the other senator, every state has two senators. The other senator is retiring early. So they're having an election for the retirement seat, the seat that's being given up through retirement, not natural election. So they're having a second election for that second seat. Now, what's interesting is because it's a separate election, there's 20 people running. Right? It's like a whole separate thing. So for the first seat, there's one Republican, one Democrat. One of those guys is going to win. And then in the second seat, there's 20 candidates, 20. So what'll happen is, I mean, obviously no one's got 50%, right? Not one candidate has 50% because there's so many candidates. So there's going to be a runoff for that. And who's going to be involved on that? I'm not actually sure. It won't be 20 people now. It'll probably be the top two or three. But now they have to fight for a 50% majority. And we'll see, right? We'll see. If it comes down to one Republican and two Democrats, the Republican would win, I think, because then the two Democrats would split the votes and not have enough to beat the Republican, right? That kind of thing.
Is that election going to be on January 5th?
Yes. Yes. That sounds right. That sounds right. But here's the thing. A lot of the trades that are on now, or the additional trades I'm going to make this week, are based on the idea that, okay, Biden won. That's fine. We just choose a different form of capitalism. That's fine. Right. We just redistribute the wealth differently, whatever. But if the Senate is balanced, or let's say the Republicans have enough veto power to push off any radical agenda, and remember, any party can make the radical agenda, so nobody wants that, right? That's why we have a Senate. If the Senate didn't matter, we'd just have a House of Representatives, right? But the Senate is important to really block anything radical, right? That's why, if you think about it, Delaware has the same power as California in the Senate. Even the small states have the same power as the big states. So there's a reason, right? It's a balance of power. So the Republicans won't be able to push through any radical agenda, but neither will the Democrats if it all kind of works out by design. So you want balance in this case. But if Georgia double dips on the Democrat side, then they own the Senate too, I think. I think that's what it's going to come down to. Or at least they only have to flip one person on a vote, and they got enough, right? So it's either they got the power, or they can have more chance of having the power. So anyways, so this is going to be an interesting election.
It will.
You know, the easy one, we're through. We're through the easy one. Hey, how many times do I have to hit this lighter? That's what I get. This is what I get. Now we'll try it. All right, it might work. Okay. In my running up and down the stairs three or four times in the last 20 minutes, one of the trips I did was to get this newspaper. And when I go, honey, where's the newspaper? She's like, I put it in your office. So anyways, I ran all the way back downstairs to get this paper, and it's our Barron's magazine. So we'll jump onto that. I didn't print out the calendar, so we'll have to use their calendar.
There, I got them on the ear hole here, and it doesn't work, so I'll...
Hang on, I got to get this going. That's why they invented fire. Hang on, I need some more fire. Give me some fire. Oh, I'll be right, I'm just right here. All right. We have plan B and plan C. All right, so anyways, we'll go through the calendar. We'll see what they wrote about. I actually brought glasses, so that's one thing I didn't screw up yet today. I've been doing school too today. But one of the conversations we're having about different types of hedge funds, I can't tell if this is even moving. Oh yeah, is this idea of if you're a hedge fund investing in the stocks and you're long only, should you have a portfolio of 50, 60, 70 stocks in your portfolio, or should you have 3 or 4? What do you guys think about that? We've been reading a lot about hedge funds recently, mid-cap stocks, big ones, tech, money managers. Which one do you think provides, or let's say outperforms the benchmark, which would be like an S&P 500? Which strategy has historically proven through empirical evidence to be the better strategy? Anyone?
Probably 3 or 4.
And why is that?
It's more targeted. Personally, I like 15 or 20. So I've got the diversity, but, you know, I'm not too exposed in any one.
Well, so that's the thing. That's what the benchmark is.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to beat the benchmark, the more you have in your portfolio, the more you're similar to the benchmark.
Right.
Right. Like, let's say you have 50 stocks and the S&P 500 has 500. Well, you're still just like a baby index, right? So if you're going to beat the index, you have to be less like the index. And then they're saying that there's a behavioral finance aspect to it, where if you have conviction because you did research and you have some sort of alpha that no one else has, like, you know, these two companies are undervalued by a lot and you know it, and you're right, you're going to outperform. Because the market's pretty good at hedging, not hedging, but more like arbitraging price disparities, where if something is a little bit oversold, people buy it up. And when it's a little overbought, they get out of it, right? And you get this sort of normal, in most mutual funds, for example, they just slightly outperform because they're closer to the S&P 500. And then, of course, they're only trying to take on so much. They can only be a little different than the broad market, right? So they can never really produce, because if you think about it, in the way that I explained, the design of this, what I think a successful Forex fund would be, is that most of your trades are going to be relatively profitable, right? And many of your trades are not going to be profitable. A big swath of your trades are essentially break even. And then there's a few bigger winners, right? Because you can't have any big losses. It's impossible if you're a professional, right? So you only have, let's say 5% of your fund are really big trades, and 45 are like, eh. And 45% are either break even or small losers. And there's just, it all adds up to like mediocrity plus that small chunk that did really well. And a mutual fund kind of gets that in way as well. So when you do a weighted average, 45% of your winners are reasonable winners, 45% are small losers, you know, another, and inside that are break evens, right? So you start doing a weighted average of this. What happens is you just end up outperforming, like a mutual fund would just by design only outperform the broad market maybe by 2 or 3%. Now the problem is, now you got to pay fees. And so after fees, you should have just done all the work yourself, right? That's why mutual funds, actually, I mean, they say they're lower risk, but at the end of the day, when you account that, you're basically only getting the S&P 500, right? Like a different version of it. Maybe they focus on a sector or something, but you can buy an index sector. But my point is, after fees, mutual funds actually don't perform that well. So you might as well just buy the entire, you know, let's say, you know, the S&P 500 and pay 0.000125% in fees versus paying a mutual fund manager 1.5% or paying your wealth manager 2% plus profit sharing, right? So anyways, so that's one of some of the math I'm doing now on performance analysis. Okay, so let's get to the calendar. All right, we always start with the numbers. Let's start with the numbers. Bitcoin price, November 6th, 15,500. When was it that we had that plan to buy it at 10,000? Was that like 6 weeks ago? Isn't that amazing? So when was the last time the US dollar moved to 50% in 6 weeks? Wow, there is the big move in, you know, 1722, right? Yeah. I mean, that's crazy, right? So it begs the question, is Bitcoin money yet? And that could, you know, that's like asking someone their opinion on abortion or something. Just asking can it can create a riot in the street. But like, it's supposed to, like, what is money? A store of value, a medium of exchange, and a unit of account. So the question is it a store of value? Or is it a speculative asset? Because, you know, you can buy and sell derivatives all day, but they're not real. Right, but you can make money trading them. So is it a tradable asset? Which obviously it is, because if you can make 50% return on your money in 6 weeks, you're doing pretty good for yourself, right? But is it truly money yet? But it can get there. I think, like, it's hard to argue, I think, my opinion right now, that you can count it as a medium of exchange, right? Unless you can go to your grocery store and buy, you know, milk and cookies with Bitcoin. Like, that's what money is, right? So if you can't do that, it's not a medium of exchange. You might argue it is a store of value. Okay, you could argue it. But I think that we need a little bit more to go on crypto, let's say. I'm not against Bitcoin, right? And I'm not against electronic forms of money and stuff. But I think we got a ways to go before it's true money, but I ain't saying it's not going to get there, just not this week. But that's what an amazing rally, huh? And if I remember it correctly, we had it all charted out, and we had to wait probably 6 weeks for it to actually make the move. Okay, what made the move happen? There was a fundamental change. You guys remember? A shock, Man in Action says. It happened way after halving. And this actually happened just a couple of weeks ago, right? PayPal's accepting Bitcoin. I think that's a big thing, because it's getting closer to a medium of exchange. Right? So if you can pay for your FX Bootcamp membership in Bitcoin through PayPal, then it becomes more of that true medium of exchange, right? And then if I can take that and pay my mortgage, even better. Okay. $66 billion, the New York Stock Exchange initial public offering volume in 2020. $66 billion in IPOs. It doesn't seem like a lot, but I guess it's good money. $14 billion, the value of convertible bonds issued so far in 2020, the highest since 2007, mostly for travel and tourism companies. Okay, who knows what a convertible bond is? So this is actually part of the class that I'm doing at Harvard right now. We're looking at different ways to structure deals. And it's funny because I already know a lot of this stuff, so they're asking me questions and I have to turn off, like, what I'm only supposed to know what I know. And so one of the questions, I'm like, I wouldn't have structured this way. I would have used a convertible note. And then, of course, the answer is, oh, well, you're supposed to use a convertible note, right? But he hadn't taught us that yet. So so here's what it is. What is a bond? What is a corporate bond? Let's start with that. Who wants to answer that question?
It's a purchasing debt of the corporation.
So if I buy a bond issued by Ford Motor Company, I'm lending money to Ford. I'm right. Acting like a bank.
Right.
And there's a there's really specific rules when it comes to making these types of investments. And you know exactly how much interest you're going to make. And you know when your payments are, when you collect your interest payments. And you know when you get all your money back, right? It's not like a mortgage. It doesn't amortize. You get interest payment every 6 months. And then after the period, whether you let the money 1 year, 5 year, 10 year, whatever, at the end of the period, the bond expires, or it's called matures, right? There's a maturity date. So at one day, the bond dies and you get all your money back, plus that final interest payment. So what if there was another sort of covenant attached to the bond that if certain things happened or at a certain time, the bond matures and is no longer a bond, but instead you own stock in the company. You go from a debt holder to an equity holder. You go from owning a income producing loan to suddenly owning a part of the company. So there's lots of reasons for doing it. And some people, like, so when we were looking at distressed investing, you know, some hedge funds, what they do is they go out and they find good companies that are struggling. So good company, good management team, good product, good cash flow, but they made some wrong decisions managerially. And all of a sudden they're like, uh-oh, we can't afford our debt anymore. So some hedge funds, what they'll do is they call up all the banks and they say, hey, I think you're loaning XYZ company some money and I think they're having some tough times. We'd like to buy their loans from you before they default. I mean, they might default, we don't know, but if they default, you're screwed, right? So like, how about we buy those loans from you? So now they own these loans and they buy them for cheaper than the face value, but then they go into the bond market and they buy a bunch of bonds because now there's different forms of debt. Some are bondholders and some are loan holders, and they have different rights to the money and have different, you know, ways of controlling what their previous investments were. And so anyways, they go out and buy just enough bonds to control all the bondholders, and then they buy enough debt to control the company. And then the whole thing is they hope the company goes bankrupt, because those loans get converted into equity, but it never happens with most bondholders. So it's a way for them to buy a company cheap, but it's a hostile takeover. These would be loans to say, look, we're Carnival Cruises and we need to borrow $10 billion, but we understand you have some doubt. So under certain circumstances, if we go into default, you will have the choice of whether you would accept ownership in the company. For example, like, we're not only going to borrow your money and pay you 10% per year, but on top of that, if it takes longer to get out of COVID and you're worried about us defaulting on you, you can convert it and now actually own the company or that share of it, right? So they're issuing it on purpose. $414 billion. The most since 2007. So what happened back in 2007? companies were distressed, right? So it's a sign that companies are distressed. Cool. So that's interesting. Let's see. 4.6 billion is the number of fines for securities related wrongdoing in 2020. You know what bugs me about this stuff? And I really got upset about this back in 2007, 2008, where they go into a bank or they go into a hedge fund and they're like, you did something wrong. You did something criminal. You clearly were, you know, defrauding people of their money. You stole over $3 billion. So we're going to charge you, you know, $900 million fine. Okay. Then, where does that money go? Does it go back to the people? Were people thrown into jail? Like, the people, if their criminal activities were happening, did they throw those people in jail? No. Did they shut the bank down? No. And if they stole $3 billion, why not charge them the $3 billion and then give it back to the people? No. So instead, they're like, we're going to shake you down, right? You give us $1 billion of the $3 billion you stole, and we'll let you go, you know, keep doing what you're doing. And when you break the law again, we'll swing on by and ask for our share. That's what it feels like to me. So $4.6 billion, where does it go? It goes to the SEC. It goes to the NFA. Any thoughts on that? How many people here think the money should go back to the people that lost the money because they were defrauded?
Compared to the revenue, it's a slap on the wrist.
Well, look, if I stole $3 billion and someone says, well, you can go to jail for the rest of your life, or you can give me $1 billion. That sounds like a pretty good deal to me, right? You're like, what? You're like, I get to keep the other two? Yeah. Like, okay, that sounds good. That sounds good to me. So, man. So, $4.5 billion this year. Boy, the SEC must be getting big. They must be hiring. Like, that's a lot of money. Holy smokes. What else? Oh, Joe Biden won the presidency. All right, let's move on. Cool. So like I was saying earlier, it's all going to be about the Senate seat. That's what's left of this election, and it's a big deal. What really matters more, I think, to us as being foreign exchange traders is the policy at the Fed. And that was declared back in May, and I haven't changed my investment thesis and bias one iota. It's exactly the same. Now, we knew the election is an event. It's an event in our path, but it won't change my investment thesis. Now, of course, if Biden wins the Senate, it brings uncertainty. Not that they're going to do something bad, but what would it be and how much change would it bring? And change always brings some heartache along the way in expense and a bunch of other things too. Like, change is difficult. Most people don't like change. Change is risky. So it might be for the right thing, but it still is different. And that difference is risk, right? So that's the only thing I think that matters right now is that Senate. The rest should be fine. I'm okay with the Joe Biden administration. Like I said, Trump's administration focused on fixing long-term inefficiencies in the global financial system, right? And in particular, from a Republican point of view. I mean, he's Republican, right? So it's not shocking. But most likely, Biden is going to call up China and say, yeah, we're not going to tariff you anymore. You don't have to worry about us. right? We're friends. We want to work with you. Everything's good. And I'm not saying that's a mistake. I'm just saying that will impact us as currency traders and in a positive way. Okay. And as a capitalist, I like it too. Now, I would like some of the trade negotiations redone. I'm not going to go into that speech because I get all fired up and I have to go back through, 40 years of trade policy. But there was a reason why it was unbalanced 20 or 30 years ago. And that reason no longer is necessary. In fact, it is hurtful. So I have no problem with Trump trying to renegotiate it. But the thing is, now as currency traders, that's not likely to continue. And if anything, the tariffs are going to drop and would just go on with free trade, which ultimately is what I wanted anyways, right? I think we could have got better terms, but whatever, we go back. We go back to doing what we were doing. And that means certainty, doesn't it? Okay. It may not be the best deal, may not be the worst deal, but it's certainty. And that means trade. Trade means money crossing borders. You want my iron ore? You send me some coin, right? And that money moving across borders is what we trade. Okay. Remember, we're arbitragers. Okay. We buy one currency and we sell the other one at the same time. So we also have to look at it on a relative basis. Who's the buyer? Who's the seller? You figure that out, you're a foreign exchange trader. It's just business, right? It's only money. So right now, when I'm looking at, the foreign exchange markets on in Barron's here. And I was going to read it, but I think it's something else, so I don't want to get into it. No need. All right. We'll skip that. If you want to read Barron's magazine, you're going to have to pay for it. It's actually worth it. I think it's the last, I mean, it is. This is the last piece of media I read, mostly because it looks like this. You see any opinions there? Yeah, no opinions. There are lots of opinion stuff, like there's a little section on commodities and a little, foreign exchange and stuff like that. But typically, I don't read them. All right. Let's see if we can get ourselves into a fund that it can rip apart. By the way, I was studying a hedge fund manager today in class, and he was interviewed by the professors. And this guy, I almost want to show you because he's so unbelievably boring, because he's so unbelievably intellectual that when you ask him a question, he can barely spit it out. And at first you think, idiot. Then he's like, well, so I gave away $3 billion last year to charity. You're like, okay, not an idiot. But I think the media shows hedge fund managers as, wild cowboys throwing down big money and models and bottles and, right, driving around in Ferraris and Lamborghinis. And I think I got this on my phone because I was laughing because it was so unbelievably boring. This is how I think hedge fund managers are. And the guys that we have to compete with, the big boys, I think, are so smart and analytical that they couldn't have a conversation with you. But they make smart decisions, and the markets are logical. I have it on WhatsApp, I think. All right, let me show you this. Okay, don't tell anybody. Which one is it? All right, don't tell anybody you saw this here. See if you can hear it. Oh my God, he's so slow. I can't even.
The concept was to.
Suppose you can't hear it, huh?
Charitable foundation through the profits of a hedge fund.
Hang on, I gotta back it up. It's only. I guess, how am I gonna have to do this? I think if you hear it, you can't see it, because I have to put my mic on it. All right, let's do that. But here's what he looks like. Oh. Do you think this guy goes out models and bottles all night, throwing down 20 grand at the bar, hanging out with LL Cool J? Does he look like that kind of guy to you? He runs the largest hedge fund in Europe. And he gives all his money away to charity. That doesn't sound like models and models. All right, let's see. Ready?
The Children's Investment Fund in and its foundation in 2003. The concept was to fund a charitable foundation through the profits of a hedge fund and do it in a public way rather than private through the name to inspire others into philanthropy. I think some investors' reaction to that fell into three buckets. Some didn't care. A handful liked it, and there were some who distinctly hated it and refused to invest if any part of the profits were explicitly diverted to charity.
Anyways, a little slow there. But the funny thing is that's heavily edited so that you can get through that 1 minute. My point here is he doesn't make mistakes. And he's got a plan. He knows what he wants to do before he does it, and they get it done. Right? So but we have to compete like we're like that too. We don't want to compete. We don't want to think everyone's an amateur and everyone's a dummy, because I kind of say that a lot when we read these, you know, interviews. But the ones that do well, they're not the ones you hear about on TV. They don't make movies about them. This guy can't even do a Harvard Business School interview. What do you do? We make money and we give it to charity, and yeah. Like, okay, and let's expand upon that. And then they have to edit and put like 20 minutes worth of stuff into a 30-second. But the thing is, he's bright. And he doesn't make mistakes. So, you know, that's why I challenge you all the time. What is your investment thesis? What is it that you're trying to accomplish as a foreign exchange trader? Make a lot of money? Make a lot of trades? Like earlier in our conversation, I said, should you just have a lot of investments or should you make two or three investments? Which one outperforms? And you're like, the one that has conviction, the one that has research. You don't want just a bunch of trades. That's called diversification. But that's not how you outperform. You outperform because the trades you make are awesome trades. You have a trend behind them. There's logic behind it. It's because the central bank of the reserve currency for the entire world made a decision, and you know what it means. And you carry that out. What's your thesis? I'm short the dollar for the next 5 years. Why? I can give you multiple reasons. Okay? It's my one thing. And this guy, by the way, makes two investments per year. You said in year one, they started with 500 million and now they have 20 billion. That's that. Okay. If you fly on an airplane in Spain, you fly through his airports. Every time you get on a plane in Spain, he gets money. Right? It's a well thought out strategy. It's just like, I own all the airports in Spain. Yeah, yeah. We. Or is it CC? See, I mean we. All right. So anyways, let's see if we got ourselves someone to laugh at here. Oh, wait. No, this might be good. A real investor here. He is the head of U.S. policy research at Cornerstone Macro. Yeah, macro. Yeah, we're macro traders, by the way. Harvard Business School, I think tomorrow, is going to teach me how to be a macro arbitrage trader. And then, you mean currency trader? I'm like, yeah. So that's going to be good. So you're a global macro trader, guys. And that's what this guy does. So let's see if he says anything interesting. He thinks if Biden wins the presidency, there's going to be a recount. All right. The guy's a genius. Maybe just a stupid question. What about the House? Looks like the Republicans will gain 10 seats, roughly roughly cutting the Democratic majority in half. That doesn't sound right. Biden is celebrated. Oh, it's all about Biden. Who cares? What does a divided government mean for markets? There we go. That's a good one. What does a divided government mean for the markets? Here's Andy's. Here's Andy. Did you get a good look at Andy? Ask, do you think this guy hangs out with Jay-Z and Beyonce? Bottles of Cristal, Andy. It's your turn, Andy. All right. I mean, seriously, it's funny, actually. They're like, stand next to that window and look cool. So he's like, well, I got my button down and I got my leather belt and I'm holding a pencil. Like, you know what it is? It's self-soothing, isn't it? Go stand by that window and we're going to take your picture. I don't like this. I don't like this. Where's my pencil? I'm going to hide behind my pencil. But anyway, so what I'm saying, though, is these guys are smart. It's not what you see on TV and in the movies. These guys are calculators. They're pocket protectors. It went from the cowboy traders stuff was in the 80s. I mean, I remember listening to an interview with this old guy who's now retired, but still gives away billions of dollars. And he made all his money on Wall Street. And he was like astrophysicist or something. He couldn't get a decent job. So someone on Wall Street hired him because you could become a trader on Wall Street just because no one else would do it. So he walked in, they're like, okay, you can be a trader. And he realized all the people around him had no quantitative approach at all. They just bought because it felt like it was cheap or something, right? So he started using some sort of methodology. And he said, the only reason I was successful is everyone was mediocre or worse. You know? So anyways, who rules the world now? Hey, Andy, stand over there and look cool. All right. But he's good at what he does, I would imagine. So anyways, you don't get tax increases. You don't get tax increases that would lower after-tax corporate profits and reduce potential GDP. With Biden, there's no lower trade risk and generalized risks associated with the second Trump term. Net, that's the best case scenario for medium-term economic and corporate profit outlook. Okay, translate that. How do I make money? Talk to me, Goose. Give me advice. I'm your client. What's going to happen in the next 2 or 3 years? Who's taking that one?
That would mean a return to a growth economy in the United States.
Okay, so now we got to translate that into assets. So what asset classes are going to do well?
So you should see the equities markets improving, the oil markets improving, and in general, investors moving funds to more risky investments potentially overseas and other areas. So you're going to see funds.
Well, sort of like the first two, I totally agree. The second one, they're not really that type of investor. Like, they're not looking to do risky deals, but any money that's been on the sidelines, like to build a factory, they're like, oh, Biden won. I feel comfortable building a factory. So it's not like it's the risk on, but all it is more like it's less risk. It's like, it gives the green light to deploy capital is all it is, right? So, but that's good. That's growth. That's good for our economy, but also it's going to be good for the other economy where that company is now building a factory in Vietnam, for example. Okay, that's good for them. But what does that do to the U.S. dollar?
That should bring in dollar weakness as having to exchange the dollars for other currencies.
Yeah, global growth, right? Global growth. We're going to invest our money globally. The money will leave the U.S. economy. That's a good thing, right? That's a good thing. So right there, that's his macro point of view, right? He says it's a best case scenario for medium-term economic and corporate profits. So remember, corporate profits go up. Well, what is the stock market? The best on future corporate profits. If Facebook is starting to lose money every quarter, its stock doesn't go up, right? If Facebook is losing money because no one's advertising anymore. So corporate profit growth is good. Okay, next question has to do with Biden's cabinet. Don't care. What are the first things you see Biden doing? Don't care. What should people be invested in? And what should they avoid? All right, let's take a next opinion. Who wants to take this one, guys? So Barron's Magazine is now asking you this question. What should people be invested in and what should they avoid? Anyone want to volunteer?
Dun, 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 dun. Well, being part of this group, they should invest in currencies.
Well, the issue is, no, like, investing in currencies only works if people invest somewhere else. We're sort of an indirect. I mean, that's not true. It's a direct, because if they make the investment, we follow the money. But if Nike in Oregon doesn't decide to build a new factory in Vietnam, then money doesn't cross borders and all that. So they're asking, like, asset classes. So let's see here. Let's see what Andy says. Andy says, with policy changes that are very moderate, it's hard to see a big impact on the dollar or bonds and interest rates. The dividend government scenario, or sorry, the divided government scenario is supportive of equity markets because the tax increases on companies, individuals, and investment income is taken off the table. So not Democrats can't jack up taxes, is what he just said. On corporates, on individuals, okay? The risk to healthcare stocks is greatly reduced, blah, 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 blah. There's moderate risk for the drug stocks, modest upside for alternative energy and infrastructure names. So it's a very, he doesn't really answer the question that well. Okay, so he thinks equity markets are going up. Let's put it that way. Mostly because there isn't a lot of change, and in particular, change that would cost businesses and people money. So if you have less money because you're taxed more, you're going to spend less money, but your money that you spend is someone else's income, which is then someone else's income, which is, you know, so the more income, right, the more money you have, the more you're going to spend is the idea. So that's cool. But what else do we know? Well, Joe had it already, right? So if we can get past COVID, for example, maybe you travel. If we can get past COVID, maybe you go on a cruise. It might be a while, right? But you drive to grandma's house for Christmas, and and you have to put money in the tank. You still buy stuff on Amazon because you feel decent about your job. Okay. Maybe even sort of a broader recovery, like less unemployment, because these companies are doing well, so they can afford to take on a little more risk and hire people. But eventually, all that is a domestic play. All of that, if it's only in the United States, has no impact on the dollar. That's what a lot of people forget. And also, I think his answer, yeah, which is strange because he's a global macro guy, but I bet you it seems like he's a global macro guy that only invests in the United States, which is funny, right? But it actually doesn't say global macro, he's just macro. So here's how he thinks. He thinks a lot like us. He looks at the business cycle, kind of like we look at the Fed cycle. And so he's saying this downturn was a contraction in the business cycle. So based on the new politics, likely until the next election, the stock market will continue to grow again. We had a very quick down, but it's a reset, and now we'll move all the way back up, and we're starting a new 8-year cycle. Well, we don't know the election 4 years from now, so all he's saying is, for now, we're going to continue this business cycle of high unemployment to suddenly lowering unemployment, right? And that'll take years to grow, but companies will benefit, and then they'll hire more. And so he's saying COVID-19 was the reset. Like, before COVID-19, everything was overbought. We had unbelievably low unemployment. Anyone that wanted a job could get a job, and so on and so forth. And that, and we reset. Now, typically what happens is inflation gets so high that the Fed has to jack up interest rates and all that kind of stuff and kills the business cycle and brings it down, which is just part of the normal. That's why we have a business cycle. He's saying his macro point of view is we got at least another 4 years, not necessarily because of politics, but the outcome of the politics doesn't impede what would be a natural growth in the cycle. We take it a little further and say, well, that means demand for a lot of things, because if American companies are doing well, they're going to, there's very few American companies, right? Like maybe the guy down the street that replaces windshields, he's a local company. But I think certainly the Dow represents international companies. It used to be the 30 biggest companies in the United States, but they're all international, right? Like, that's an international play now. So if they're doing well, they're investing globally, they're doing business globally, money is going to happen and money is going to flow. So we look at that, the growth cycle of business cycles on top of central banking policy like interest rates. And so I made that decision 5 months ago. He's making the decision now. It's not that I'm ahead of the curve. It's that we adjust for different reasons. Okay, and we're both right. So what he's saying tells me dollar weakness, but the dollar's got to go somewhere. Remember, this is arbitrage. So if I'm selling the dollar, I got to buy something. And in the last few months, I've been telling you, look, I'm selling the dollar, but I'm not actually buying anything, right? Meaning when I look at pound dollar, I might be buying it, but I'm not actually buying the pound, I'm selling the dollar. So now over the course of time, I need to also do the other side, the demand side of my equation. What do I want to own? I haven't made that decision yet. I know what I want to sell, right? And I'll get paid for that when I buy it back, AKA taking profit, right? That's the opposite of arbitrage. So now I'm short selling the US dollar. Over the next few months, I'm going to have to probably pick the winners. And I still need more information to make those decisions. And most likely I'll make that decision in March and start effectively doing that April, May, June, right? Because I want to hold through the summer. So anyways, let's see if they talk about anything else. Here's a funny question. Let's see if you guys want to answer this one. Will Biden seek re-election 4 years from now when he's 81 years old? Depends on the interns, right? And Clinton would have run for the third term. Says it's unlikely that Biden will seek re-election either. Kamala is going to do it, is what he says. Nice. So I don't know much about her, but my wife was telling me, we had a conversation. I'm like, yeah, I don't really know much about her. So we had, and apparently she got married late in life, doesn't have children of her own. She's African American. She hired a Jewish man with two children. She's an interesting person. So clearly she's dedicated her life to law and career and politics, and isn't constrained with normal sort of stereotypes or whatever, right? Just whatever. She seems to be a person that lives the way that she wants to live. I think that's cool. Ada says she's not African American. I'm not even sure if I'm supposed to say African American anymore. I thought she was mostly black with some Indian, American Indian, Native. I don't know, that's a complicated one too. So I don't know, but she's a woman of color. She's half Indian. Okay. So made us still know. Okay. So look, I don't follow these things. Like I just said this morning, I'm like, I don't know anything about her except that she's smart. So I like maybe that she, I don't know, maybe a bit of a, I don't know, let's say a free spirit. She does what she thinks she is right and what she wants. She does what she wants. Oh, it, truly it, from India, Indian. Okay, good. And Jamaican. Indian, Jamaican. Cool. Right on. Jamaican father, Indian mother. Cool. Right on. Dedicator, where did she go to school? Does anyone know where she got her law degree? Yeah, she put a lot of people in jail. Good. Does anyone know? She's a California girl, right? Bay Area, Oakland, so maybe a Hosk. Anyways, cool. Good for her. So this guy is saying that Kamala is going to be the first Indian, Jamaican, American female president. So anyways, Hastings. Yeah, that's what I thought. Okay, I was thinking Haas, but that's a business school. Hastings, it's a good school. A little bit liberal. Liberal for even Harvard. But cool, that's where she is. So, hey, smart. She knew what she wanted at a young age. And I think she kicks ass to get what she wants. So, good. She'll wake up Biden every so often. Wake up. Cool. All right, so we didn't go through the calendar. Oh, God, dang it. Did you guys like non-farm payrolls? Would you like to talk for 3 hours while nothing's happening? All right. Did you guys catch it? Number 175. It was all FX bootcampers. It was amazing. I sent FX Street an email. I'm like, come on. Come on, guys. Come on. Wait, come on. I love you guys, but it was all bootcampers. Like, come on. You get 10 million Forex viewers a month. Like, come on, you got to promote that a little better. So let's see if I can find the calendar. I didn't see it. Oh, it's over there. No wonder. By the way, I heard Jim Carrey got a lot of hate mail because he played Joe Biden on Saturday Night Live. Did you guys see when he did that? I thought he was funny. I thought it was good. You guys didn't see it? Jim Carrey came out. And he's got the Biden gray hair on and everything, and he comes out like it's just funny. It's just funny. And apparently, man, there's too many haters, man. There's you do anything these days, and people are gonna hate on you. It's amazing. I thought it was funny. No one saw it. No one saw. You don't watch Saturday Night Live. You're like, once Dana Carvey was gone, you're like, that's it, no more. All right, let's go through this. This is from the American point of view, so we're not going to get all of it, but let's say this is all U.S. dollar related news. Okay. Monday is Credit Suisse kicks off its annual healthcare conference. Cool. A lot of these, by the way, these investor events are now streamed, virtual events. I wonder if we can get into some of these. What's up, Rolu? All right. What do we care? Zoom info reports, SoftBank reports. You guys know SoftBank? One of the largest investment funds in the world. They own something like 40% of the Japanese stock market. In my last, not in the Harvard Business School class, but in my other Harvard class, by the way, I officially graduate Tuesday. Like, they're mailing out the degree. Nice. Master. But in that last class, we had the head of global investing, the country head for investing in India and Asia for SoftBank. Like, he oversees, it was obscene, like $100 billion or something, this one guy oversees. And he's like, Wayne, what do you do with all those screens behind you? I'm just a humble currency trader. But anyways, so SoftBank's big. So if you imagine one guy manages $100 billion for SoftBank, there's more than one guy at the company. It's big. So they're huge. Okay. Monday, Federal Reserve Bank of Philadelphia starts its two-day virtual fintech conference. Mester, president of the Cleveland Fed, will deliver a keynote speech. Cool. Mester's a lady, by the way. Mester's a woman. So yeah, there's something you can attend. Anyone going to be that pocket protector, hide behind the pencil and go to the Federal Reserve Bank of Philadelphia virtual fintech conference and listen to Mester, the president of the Cleveland Fed? Might be an interesting thing. You should do it. You never know where you'll pick up a tidbit, right? You never know. That could be something you do while you're just eating lunch. Okay, let's see. Tuesday. The National Federation of Independent Businesses releases its Small Business Optimism Index for October. Cool. The Bureau of Labor Statistics releases its job openings and labor turnover survey. Who knows something about that? Okay. So my story with this is when I took a macroeconomics class, my professor was the senior, at that time was the senior economist at the Boston Fed, and this was one of his loves. So we have non-farm payrolls, which just tells you an establishment survey of jobs, which means they look at payroll stubs from corporations. And then there's a household survey where they call a bunch of people who are like, hey, do you have a job? And the guy is like, well, I have three lousy paying jobs. I do Uber, I clean dishes. And the guy's like, I'm not interested in all that blah, 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 wah, wah, wah. Just do you have a job? Yeah, great, thank you, click. And that's the survey. So they get different types of data. Now there's this other thing called Job Openings and Labor Turnover Survey. It's called JOLTS. And when you take so what it's looking at is how many jobs are being advertised in America right now, and what kind of people are looking for jobs. So how many unemployed people right now have an expertise in artificial intelligence programming? That they know machine learning, deep statistics, deep data, and they can program it. Do you think there are a lot of jobs for that? So a friend of mine, after her second child, started taking artificial intelligence classes at Stanford University while working full-time, while raising two children and being married, all of which have their own stresses. So she knocked all that out, which is really, like I said, it's complicated stuff. So when she got her certificate of completion, whatever, from Stanford, Apple hired her the next day. So if you don't have a job and you want a job, you should become an artificial intelligence engineer and you can work at Apple. So this is a study of what jobs are available and what kind of labor is available. And one of the things that he introduced to the class was his own analysis of putting these together. And we looked at the history of JOLTS going back decades. And what the Boston Fed is seeing in this JOLTS report. And what they said is there's a line here that represents all the number of jobs available. And there's a line up here of all the people are available. And for the, you know, most significantly over the course of time, they don't match at all. Like usually like kind of they blur, right? Like half the jobs would get filled really quickly by half the people looking for jobs. And then you'd have a few outliers above and below. Some people are not qualified for anything. And some jobs are too complicated for anybody to actually do. Right now there's like, and this is all before COVID, by the way. COVID was an exogenous shock that didn't have anything truly to do with the labor force. That wasn't a slowdown in the business cycle. That was like it crushed the business cycle. But that was where we were before. One of the reasons we have haves and haves not. The jobs are complicated jobs, but if you qualify, you make a lot of money. So that's another reason for the income disparity and the income gap, right? if you could probably go to school in 6 years, get a really good job as an artificial, and like, let's say you don't have a college degree at all. You can start, you know, start your first class, basic entry level, freshman classes, how to write good, how to spell good, how to math good, right? And in 6 years, you can go all the way through and you can teach a computer how to giggle at a moderately funny joke. And if it'll only take you 6 years, that's the amazing thing. Now you can even take it further. You can probably skip half the nonsense from a traditional university, because the first 2 years in American university, you repeat everything you were supposed to learn in high school. First 2 years are a total waste. By the way, it costs you $100,000. Okay. And then the second, then you start to learn a little bit. You can skip all of that. Probably just go to edX, right? And take university classes for $5 per class and get the knowledge, and probably only take you, let's say, 4 years to become an expert in big data, statistical analysis, programming, and then specialize in artificial intelligence. And you probably get $140,000 to $150,000 entry level job and work your way up to $300K pretty quickly. Most people don't do it though. That's the problem. That's the problem. If you think about that, within your first 10 years as an AI programmer, you'll probably make $1 million. And it'll cost you probably $300 to get the education, but it'll cost you 6 years of your life too. So it's an interesting, so the jolts thing, they don't line up. And that's a big significant problem. Is it the Fed's problem though? Or is it the government's problem? Well, the market's opening in 5 minutes. Oh, I gotta go. So what else? Let's see what else. Bond markets are closed on Wednesday. Oh, it's Veterans Day. Yeah, 11-11. Very cool. So in Canada, you wear little pins with the poppy and all that. Let's see. Thursday, BLS reports the consumer price index for October. Wow, is it that late in the month already? I guess so. Yeah, that's the 12th. Usually comes out closer to the 15th. Expectations are for 1.3 year over year. Okay. Okay. Core is interesting because traditionally core is higher than headline, but the last few months it's been the opposite because oil was free, right? So so it's core is higher, so it's really strange. So we'll see when that changes. That might be an interesting sign. And then on Friday, University of Michigan releases its preliminary garbage index of consumer sentiment, garbage. All right, and then what? BLS again, they're busy this week, huh? Releases producer price index. Okay, and that has to do with inflation at the producer level, and that usually moves up first, and then CPI moves up as companies can't eat the increase in costs, so eventually they have to pass it on to consumers. Cool. Looks like the BLS is going to be busy this week. So since the markets are opening, I think it's time to bid you adieu. I apologize for the late start. But it was nice hanging with you. Thank you for participating. I wish you an amazing week. I hope you crush it. I hope you have your plans ready to go. I hope you're ready to buy some dips.
Hey, thanks, anyway. Wayne. Appreciate it. We will see you in the morning.
Yeah, I'll see you. Yeah, that's right. I'll see you at forex.today. And of course, if you're new to FX Bootcamp's YouTube channel, please subscribe. I need like 90 more subscribers. Yeah, thanks, Pip Pirates. Any last questions? No? Oh, then I'll see you guys in the morning. So peace on earth. All right. May the pips be with you. May your profits be above average. And I'm sorry I didn't drink a wine or scotch with you guys today, but this cigar is pretty epically good.
See you guys.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Well, yeah, I have to go inside to turn it off. All right. Goodbye.